You're watching Reality Check. Tonight is the fifth anniversary of the note ban, that dramatic move in November 2016 when the Prime Minister came on TV to announce a ban on high-value currency in a single stroke, hailed at that time as a game-changer. But today, 5 years on, the government is totally silent on its supposed masterstroke. While note ban divas, so to speak, is trending thanks to the critics of the decision, widely described by them as a disaster. Right from the start, assessing the targets of the note ban, was it a disaster or was it a game changer, was always a challenge, since the goalposts kept shifting from reducing black money to making India cashless and so on and so forth. So for our reality check tonight, we chose five significant aims of demonetization, starting with the goals outlined in the Prime Minister's famous speech, which we've edited to highlight the initial goals in Mr. Modi's own words.
Black money, black money, black money, black money. Role of black money and black money. Of black money and black money. This fight against corruption, 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 corruption and corruption earned through corruption. Corruption against corruption to the corrupt. Fake currency, fake 500 and 1000 rupee notes, fake currency notes and fake currency. Problem of terrorism, terrorism and terrorism. Terrorist, terrorism and terrorism.
So black money mentioned 17 times, 17, corruption 16 times, fake currency and terrorism 5 times each. These were the initial goals. What's the claim and what's the reality? So the claim was that black money will be eradicated. The reality was that over 99% of the cash returned back to the banks. So of the rupees 15.4 lakh crores which was out there in the economy, 15.3 lakh crores came back according to the RBI data. Huge tranches of black cash which was supposed to be thrown into the river or burnt or discarded never quite happened. The second claim from the Prime Minister's initial speech that the note ban was meant to curb terrorism. The reality is that there was no dramatic drop in terrorism despite the note ban. Let's look at the data for Jammu and Kashmir, India's most terror-prone state, starting from 2014, if one looks at the figure, 2016 it was 322 incidents, started to climb, hitting 600 incidents in 2018, 2019, almost again 600, finally before falling in 2020. Claim number three, eliminating fake currency notes. The reality of this, that of all the banned cash, only rupees 58 crore fake currency was detected since 2016-17, which is less than 0.004% of all the lakhs and crores of demonetized currencies. All of that was wiped out ostensibly just to detect this fractional amount. The government then of course soon started moving the goalposts, claiming that the idea was to move to a less cash or cashless economy. The reality is that cash in circulation today has surged 64% since the note ban. The cash in circulation on November 4th, 2016, just before the announcement, was rupees 18 lakh crores. October 29, 2021, is almost 30 lakh crores of the amount of cash that's circulating in the economy. The final significant goalpost was that the note ban, and this was again new goalpost, the note ban was meant to usher in a digital economy. Now here the record seems more nuanced. So the claim is of course note ban to usher a digital India. The reality is this, that digital payments did rise after the note ban, but, and there is a but, there have been pre-note ban years which actually saw similar if not higher percentage growth of digital payments. Let's look at the chart starting from 2012-13, about 4 years before the note ban. And as you can see, we go big screen, 2012-13 it was actually 30% up. Then it came down 10%, 5%, 10%, and then from 2016-17 onwards it started growing at about 20%. But then again in 19 and 20, it fell by a percentage. And of course, it then fell more significantly because of the pandemic. So that's the story of the claims and the reality of note ban. Joining me tonight, Rajneesh Kumar, former chairman, State Bank of India, India's biggest bank. We have with us Ashwini Deshpande, professor of economics at Ashoka University. Gaurav Vallabh, spokesperson of the Congress, is with us. And PKD Nambiar, political analyst, supports the BJP. Ashwini Deshpande, when one looks at it now in terms of, as I said, it's hard to actually pin down a goal because the goalposts kept shifting. But if you look at the facts, tested against even the shifting goalposts on almost every count, whether it's to do with turning us into a cashless economy or whether it's to do in terms of eradicating black money, note ban seems to have failed, and with tremendous human consequences.
Yeah, Srinivasan, you're absolutely right, and you gave all the right figures to show how even against the stated claims of the government, the note ban didn't really work, demonetization. On top of that, the human cost, the suffering to the people of India has been enormous. In fact, we won't ever know the widespread devastation that note ban caused, because India is largely an informal economy. A very large proportion of India's workers work in informal enterprises, or they work in formal enterprises but are themselves informal workers.
Right.
And so this is the reality of India. The formal sector constitutes at most 25% of the workforce, and that's a very generous estimate.
Right.
And the informal sector deals in cash. You know, I was reading the State Bank report recently, and I was shocked to see, and I wrote that down, that the informalization of the economy is an issue of data capture or a compliance issue. So it's as if people are choosing to work in the informal economy because they don't want to comply with regulations.
Right.
That's a completely wrong way of looking at the Indian economy. It's without empathy. It's without an understanding of the underlying economic structure. So an economy where small cash is what is needed for the livelihoods and daily needs of millions of people.
Right.
When you ban notes overnight, there's a tremendous human cost.
Right.
And my, you know, I've done some research now on the impact on women's labor force participation rate, along with my student Jitendra Singh. And we find actually that women's labor force participation rate that was already declining after the November 2016 note ban, it fell by a further 2 percentage points relative to the male labor force participation rate.
Okay.
And this is an, you know, so there are all kinds of
many
consequences.
Right. Many repercussions. Rajneesh Kumar, let me come to you. You are the author most recently of Custodian of Trust, a banker's memoir. Now, let me ask you this, because on one hand, you have this huge human cost, but if the goals were met, not that that mitigates the cost, you at least say, okay. But as a banker, you were, I believe, in the saddle when the announcement happened, cash started coming to the banks. Were you in the end surprised at all to find that actually, contrary to the claims that lakhs of crores of cash would not return to banks, and that is this great amount of section of black money that will get wiped out, 99.9% money actually came back to the banks?
No, that is the ingenuity of the Indian people. Let me put it this way. Because you had a very large population.
Right.
And with bank accounts. And the people, they found a way of channelizing their cash. The, whether it was a black money or not, that is a different issue.
Sure.
Because the definition would be of the black money is about that, whether you are paying taxes and you are declaring income.
Correct.
So cash does not necessarily mean black money.
Of course.
So that is the one thing. But yes, the money got channelized into the into the banking system. That is the reality.
So then,
Just a minute.
Yes. Go ahead. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah. So basically, you had a large number of people. Out of like say 139 crore people, there are at least 100 or 110 crore people who live on a very meager resources.
Yes.
And putting 4,000, 5,000, 10,000, 50,000 rupees in their account.
Right.
So the people found, the people who had the cash, who had the money, so they found various ways. And right. that way, like it was the genius of Indian people.
That they,
that they didn't
cash.
Go let go their money
okay.
return the cash to
okay.
the banking
in that
system.
Case, in that case,
but
in that case,
yeah,
let
yeah.
me come back to you. In that case, PKD Nambiar, we come back to the burning question: what has this achieved? And I guess, in a way, if you look at the facts, not very much. Does that explain why the government, the BJP, is now completely silent?
The achievement of this, the demonetization to me is that more than 2.1 lakh one lakh companies, they are basically paper companies which are only used for transacting money from here and there, have been scrapped or been it's been over. They were all paper companies who were only doing the dubious the billing exercise, which we all know that how it works, that they have been wiped out from the system. So in a way,
that is a, now you've listed another goalpost. See, that's the whole point.
No,
now you're talking of paper companies. These were not even part of the Prime Minister. You're now bringing up aspects which are not even part of the Prime Minister's claims. I'm saying, let us just go by what the government's initial claims were. Goalposts change on a daily, weekly basis. But everything from fighting terrorism to eliminating black money to saying we're going cashless. Where has that happened? Cash in circulation has increased 64%.
Srinivasan, I think you haven't understood. I think these companies were, these shell companies or these paper companies was one of the reasons that being used for the terrorist activities, which is very well known, and you can ask any economist in the country, they will all know it. Now coming to the second part of it. More than 1.8 lakh accounts are under observation or under scrutiny, examination,
okay.
which basically for the black money. Because once the money, as the former SBI chairman was talking about,
yeah.
when the money comes to your account,
yes.
now there is a source for you to find out whether these monies are genuine.
How much
or
has been found?
It's a massive one, 1.8 lakh.
No, I'm saying how much of these accounts, because we've been hearing about these accounts from day one, because the goalpost shifted. It was first to eliminate the cash in the system, the hoarded cash. Then it changed to, no, we actually wanted the cash to come back. So now we'll scrutinize to see what is the black cash. I'm still waiting to hear from the government of these lakhs of accounts how much money has found to be black. And it's not fair to ask you because I don't think the government has disclosed that information to anybody.
Now you are asking me a question, but your question is so long, but you have not even allowed me to tell you something. One.
You have an answer. I'd love to hear it because I have to move on.
To you that you allow me to have a 1-2 sentence.
Okay. No. So how much cash has been discovered in these accounts?
I'm saying that the overall demonetization effect, there may be side effect, there may be bad effect, there may not have been achieved all those goals set by the Prime Minister.
Okay.
I accept that. But having said that,
there were still some positives. All right.
That is not true.
Okay. Well, let me come back to you because also there's a little bit of an audio issue. I'll use that time while we're talking to Gaurav Vallabh. We'll just get that fixed. PKD, I'll just come back to you. You're saying, Gaurav Vallabh, at least you have an unusual instance of a spokesperson or a person representing the BJP saying, listen, it may not have all been great, but at least there were some positives. But you, the Congress party, has said overall unmitigated disaster.
Srinivas, I will start with two dates which had changed the Indian economy forever. The first date was July 24, 1991, when that time Finance Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh gave liberalization, privatization and globalization to our economy. And the second date, and this date I call as a black day for Indian economy, that is November 8, 2016. And I will give you the reasons. In that year, Srinivas, in that year, 16-17, our GDP growth was 8.3%. And before Corona, for the financial year 19-20,
yeah.
it was 4.2%. what happened in between this?
We only have the GDP chart actually. We'll put it up as you speak. Yes, go ahead, Gauravallabh.
Correct. What happened during that? Only one event had happened. That is demonetization. 18 lakh crore rupees is the currency in circulation at that time of at that point of time. Today it is 29 lakh crore. It means 64% of jump. Had our GDP increased by 64%, as per my data, it had increased by 11%. Because the GDP number for the year 2016-17 was 121 lakh crore.
Right,
today
but Gaurav,
it is 135 lakh.
Okay, but
so
Gaurav,
No,
Gaurav Vallabh, the argument being made is, okay, all that may be, but political parties, particularly like yourselves, opposition parties, were upset because all of you were sitting on black money, which got wiped out.
I am asking, because the government was in of BJP on that day and today also, how much black money you had confiscated from any political party? I am raising this question. The gentleman here, Mr. Nambiar, had raised that we had reduced the shell companies. Can he prove that demonetization is anything to do with the identification of shell company? That was another exercise. He is not aware of the fact. Only who is the person who had been adversely affected? It is the Indian economy,
right.
The inclusive Indian economy, which was growing at 8 to 9%. Now it is at 4%.
Let me come back to you, PKD. Now you want to rebut? I will come back to you. But Ashwini Deshpande, as you were saying, that government may be silent, but 5 years later, the tremors of demonetization continue to be felt, particularly by the poor and the informal sector. As you mentioned, women's labor force participation has fallen. But the curious thing, Ashwini Deshpande, is that despite that, Indians heavily still depend on cash.
Yeah.
That they've actually gone back, even though it was meant to give people a scare that you shouldn't be actually transacting in cash and keep little cash stockpiles. It almost seems to have had the reverse effect.
No, so in fact, you have been giving figures of absolute amount of cash in circulation. If you see the cash to GDP ratio in the fiscal 2021, it's 14.5%. And in 2016, it was 11.6%. So as a proportion of our GDP, the cash in circulation
has gone up,
has actually increased post demonetization. That's one.
Right.
The second thing, you know, the people are talking about corruption, black money, etc., etc. If demonetization had to have the impact of increasing formalization and increasing widening the tax net, making the money whiter, then tax to GDP ratio should have shown an increase. If anything, between 2017-18 and 2021, tax to GDP ratio has marginally declined. Tax to GDP, not absolute amount of taxes, tax to GDP ratio. So on both of these counts, even taking, forget about the human suffering and the pain, but even when you look at cash to GDP and tax to GDP ratios, tax to GDP has fallen, cash to GDP has increased. And that's the most bizarre outcome, which flies in the face of all the arguments that
made
were initially
in the favor.
Offered to favor demonetization.
Right. Rajnish Kumar, because actually we didn't even get into other claims, which was that this was going to increase greater tax compliance. We fact-checked those in the past. As Ashwini points out, the first effect seems to be the reverse. As a banker, how do you explain this paradox that far from actually weaning Indians away from cash, the appetite and the use and the circulation of cash has jumped since note ban?
No, I think one is convenience of cash. The second is, again, I'm saying that in terms of the digital transactions, India can be proud of its achievement. There is no doubt about it.
Right.
There is nowhere in the world a system like UPI,
right,
which India has built.
Yes.
So, apart from what the economists say or political debate,
yes.
So my take is that on one single decision and on economy, its impact, you are trying to map it, that one single decision and this one are the outcomes. But my take is that during the last 5 years, there are several decisions of the government, and COVID is a decision of the God. So these are the combination of at least five major factors which are today impacting the Indian economy. So one was demonetization, of course.
Yes.
The other is GST,
correct,
introduction of insolvency code.
Correct.
then you have the COVID. So when you are analyzing on impact on the economy and the direction, and if you are saying that if the claim is that it is a Brahmastra and which would eliminate all the problems, then that narrative obviously would not be correct.
Right.
So demonetization has not proved to be a Brahmastra which would eliminate all the problems.
Right.
But the fact is, and I am now giving you a comment as an impartial observer who has nothing to do with politics, and I don't have an economics background. I am a practicing banker.
Yes.
So if you have to attack terrorism, for example, so one is, okay, like you have to cut the funding sources.
Right.
So whatever I have read in the newspapers or keep on reading, there has been a very systematic effort to cut the sources of funding. We cannot deny that.
That is okay.
So, I think a little bit more explanation.
No, no, I'll come back to that. But you see, even when you talk of cutting the sources of funding for terror, this is something which didn't start with demonetization. This is something that has been going on for a long time. And this is not necessarily something.
Sure. It could be one action.
Of course, it could be
one
action.
So, demonetization.
I agree. But
so, communication wise, I don't see that.
When you make a huge.
Yeah, you go ahead,
step,
then I will answer. Yeah.
I know. I'm saying when you. We are only assessing claims made by the government against the magnitude of the step. When you are cancelling 90% of currency in circulation, that's a massive, massive shock to the system. Then you have to be very clear about what you're setting out to do. It can't be business as usual. If you look at the data on terrorism, you look at any of the data, it's not showing any big change or shift post-demonetization. So that's the cost-benefit analysis of inflicting so much pain on a population of our size and assessing what's the gain. But sorry, I need to allow now.
But
Pikiri
I can
Nambiar,
just one answer I will give you again, just from my practical experience.
Yes.
And then you can go to others, because as I said that I am not a political person, so take would be different. But the reality is, and I have mentioned in my book, then when I was talking to the people who were standing in the queue.
Yes.
Surprisingly, they were willing to bear that pain because they sincerely believed that it is a decisive strike against the rich.
Of course.
So I am telling you and conveying you what I heard from the people standing in the queue.
I myself have gone and covered. Of course, I have covered those queues. I've heard people's views. But in a democracy, the job of the media is to test views and opinions and emotions and sentiments with hard facts. And that's what we're trying to do tonight. But PKD Nambiar, coming to you, this whole idea where not just, I mean, forget tax collection, which has not seen a dramatic shift, as Ashwini said, cash to GDP ratio has actually gone up. Even growth, India was ticking along just fine at over 8%. We put that growth chart up again. Look at what happens after demonetization. Again, it may not be the only reason. As Rajnish Kumar said, there was GST, so many factors. But far from actually even achieving some of its goals, demonetization may have contributed to hurting India's growth. Yeah, I think you're on mute.
Your views, what the fact which you're saying may not be completely true. It may be partly correct, it may be partly incorrect. For an example,
so GDP
from the
is government
of,
data. There's no disputing that. Yeah.
I am only saying that, for an example, our income tax collections have increased by 71%. Why it has happened? Because formalization of economy has taken place with demonetization. As I said, there may be a lot of flaws which may happen because this is the first time which has happened something like this in such a magnitude, in such a surprising way. There may have been some flaws. I mean, I think it will be too immature for me to say that everything what happened in demonetization was good. But one thing you need to understand and accept, today we are a much better formalized economy, and the formalization of economy has happened because of demonetization.
You can't say that. You can't make these statements, at least, sorry, on my show without facts. You mentioned tax. Ashwini just finished telling us tax to GDP has actually fallen. Number one, when you talk of greater formalization, the fact that there is more cash in circulation, 64% increase actually raises a question.
What was the number of bank accounts in Indians had before demonetization and post-monetization?
Anyway, just have a proper
understanding of the data. You just tell me, you have also have a banker sitting on the show. Tell me, what was the number of accounts you had 70 years of India or 65 years of India and post-demonetization?
That has nothing to do with demonetization. That is Jan Dhan, the opening of no-frills accounts which predated demonetization.
That is when the direct transfer also started happening, Srinivasan.
Okay, we'll have to leave it there.
You asked for the truth and economics who you wanted to hear only that much of that.
Srinivas, I would like to make a
last. If I only wanted to hear an echo chamber PKD, why would we call you? So that's not fair. But anyway, we are out of time. Gaurav Vallabh, we'll have you back. We will continue to keep an eye on this and other big stories here on Reality Check. Thank you for watching. Good night.